So good morning everyone. Thank you very much. Almost 34 people to join him for joining early morning. It is very cold winter, especially northern part of India. But I can see a lot of northern part of India have also joined. And thank you, Kunal, for preparing a very important topic on advanced care planning and how to handle a patient when patient is almost in the end stage of heart failure or end stage of heart diseases. I will request Dr. Joyita, because Kunal has done his residency from TMH. So again, the same thing, that no one can introduce us better than a teacher to anybody for a student, because they know the best about the student. So I'll request Dr. Joyita to introduce Kunal, and then we will have a question answer at the end. Please write down question answer in the chat box. Arun will take care of all those questions. Go ahead, Dr. Joyita, please.
Thank you, Sushma Madam. Always a privilege to be part of this IPC online series lectures. And especially a privilege when faculty is from Tata Memorial Hospital and has done the training. So it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Kunal Ranjan Panayak to everyone. Dr. Kunal joined us as the fifth batch of our MD Palliative Medicine training program. And he completed his post-graduation in 2019, following which he did a one-year SR-ship in Tata Memorial Hospital. And after that, he has been appointed as assistant professor in our Varanasi hospitals, which is HPCH and MPMMCC there. So he, because Varanasi Hospital has to be set up, he is helping and taking charge of different projects there, like the teleconsultation for home care services and establishing pediatric palliative care services at HPCH Hospital. He's also, because he has done his thesis in pediatric palliative care, and he is taking that interest forward. And I know that he's working with dedication for that. He's also been faculty in different training programs, as you can see in the year-end review in lung cancer, and in different oncology CMEs, and latest in the understanding, evaluation, and management of pain in oncology. So we are looking forward to Dr. Kunal giving the talk on this palliative care in heart failure and advanced care planning. Over to you, Dr. Kunal.
Yeah, ma'am, thank you. Hello and good morning, everyone. Welcome to the IAPC academic session. Welcome to the new topic, that is palliative care in heart failure. I'll straight away move on to the topic with the contents. Next, please. The contents includes the definition of the heart failure, etiology of heart failure, pathophysiology of heart failure, diagnosis and management, the PC needs in heart failure at the end of life, palliative cardiovascular care, guidelines for the palliative care in chronic heart failure, and advanced care planning, along with the barriers that we face with cardiac palliative care. Next, please. Now, moving on with the definition, heart failure can be defined as an abnormality of cardiac structure or function leading to failure of the heart to deliver oxygen at a rate commensurate with the requirement of the metabolizing tissues despite normal filling pressures, or only at the expense of increased filling pressure. Next, please. Now, the etiology. Etiology of heart failures are varied. It includes valvular heart diseases, pericardial diseases, high output states like anemia, sepsis, thyroid toxicosis, Paget's disease, and AV fistula, volume or overloads like renal failure, or somebody who has been infused postoperatively a lot of fluids, congenital heart disease, arrhythmias, endocardial diseases, and myocardial diseases. Next, please. Now, moving on to the important aspect, that is pathophysiology of heart failure, which includes ventricular failure leads to decreased cardiac output, It leads to decrease in arterial pressure, which leads to activation of the sympathetic system along with release of angiotensin II and aldosterone and vasopressin. This leads to increased blood volume and venous stones. This increases the venous pressure, which leads to pulmonary edema and systemic edema. This venous pressure also leads to release of atrial natriuretic peptide, which are counterbalancing products, counterbalancing peptides, which tries to improve the vicious cycle that has been generated for pathophysiology. Next, please. Now, injury to the myocytes due to myocardial infarction or other causes, this leads to ventricular remodeling. This ventricular remodeling leads to electrical instability and reduction of ejection fraction. It also activates the neurohumoral imbalance, which starts the vicious cycle of the heart failure. The imbalance occurs in three key neurohumoral systems, that is the TRAS system, the sympathetic nervous system, the natriuretic peptide system. The systemic response in the renin angiotensin and sympathetic aldosterone and sympathetic nervous systems cause further myocardial injury and have detrimental effect on the blood vessels and various organs, thereby creating a pathophysiological vicious cycle. The natriuretic, it is not visible at my scene. The natriuretic peptide system has a protective function, which can counterbalance this detrimental effect. Next, please. The clinical classifications. It is divided into backward, forward, left-sided and right-sided heart failures. In the backward, we have the inability of the ventricles to eject its content, resulting in elevated filling pressure. In the forward heart failure, there is decreased cardiac output and inadequate tissue perfusion is there. In the left-sided heart failure, left ventricle is weakened or overloaded. I have lost the screen. The left ventricle is overloaded, and which leads to pulmonary edema. Ma'am, I cannot see the screen.
Is it back?
Hi, it is back.
Okay.
In the right-sided heart failure, right ventricle is impaired, which results in systemic venous overload. Next, please. Now, different terminology in heart failures. The types of heart failure is also divided into heart failure due to reduced ejection fraction, heart failure due to mildly reduced ejection fraction, heart failure due to preserved ejection fraction. In the heart fraction due to reduced ejection fraction, the ventricular ejection fraction is less than equal to 40%. In mildly reduced type, it is 41 to 49%. In the preserved one, it is greater than 50%, greater than equal to 50%, which leads to heart failure due to preserved ejection fraction, very difficult to diagnose. Therefore, we require other criteria like objective evidence of cardiac structure or the functional abnormalities consistent with the presence of LV diastolic dysfunction or raised LV pressures, including raised natriuretic peptide. Next, please. Now, the symptoms and signs of heart failure. Symptoms and signs of heart failure includes breathlessness, orthopnea, paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea, reduced exercise tolerance, fatigue, tiredness, increased time to recover after exercise. The various specific signs include elevated jugular venous pressure, hepatic jugular reflexes, gallop rhythm, that is the third heart sound is heard, laterally displaced apical impulses are there, and cardiac murmur is what we see here. Next, please. Now, according to American College of Cardiology or American Heart Association, heart failure has been divided into four stages, which are based on structure and damage of the to the heart. Stage A includes at high risk for HF, but without structural or functional abnormality. There is no signs or symptoms that we see in this patient. Stage 2, developed structural heart disease strongly associated with development of heart failure, but without signs and symptoms. In stage 3, there is symptomatic heart failure associated with underlying structural heart disease. In stage 4, that is stage D, advanced structural heart disease and marked symptoms of HF at rest are present despite maximal medical therapy. According to NYHA functional classification, which is based on symptoms or physical activities, it is divided into four classes. Class one, there is no limitation of physical activities. Ordinary physical activity does not cause undue fatigue, but palpitation or dyspnea. Type two, there is slight limitation of physical activities, comfortable at rest, but ordinary physical activity results in heart failure symptoms. In class three, there is marked limitation of physical activity, comfortable at rest, but less than ordinary activity results in heart failure symptoms. Stage four, symptoms of heart failure present at rest. If any physical activity is undertaken, discomfort is increased. Next, please. Now the evaluation of the heart failure. Evaluation of the heart failure requires comprehensive history taking, physical examination, laboratory test, and diagnostic test are required. Next, please. Now the diagnostic algorithm for heart failure. For diagnosis of the heart failure, the suspected heart failure, we see the risk factors, then we see the symptoms and the signs, and the abnormal ECGs are seen. Then NT-proBNP, that is greater than, then we do the test NT-proBNP. If it is greater than 125 picogram per ml, or brain natriuretic peptide that is greater than 25 picogram per ml, then we go ahead with, if it is so, then we go ahead with the echocardiography. If echocardiography findings are abnormal, then we discriminate it, classify it according to whether it is heart failure due to reduced ejection fraction or mildly reduced ejection fraction or preserved ejection fraction, as has been explained earlier, that is less than 40% ejection fraction, that is reduced, 41 to 49%, that is mildly reduced, and greater than 50% for preserved ejection fraction. Next, please. So the lab analysis for this heart failures includes CBCs, serum electrolyte and creatinine, fasting blood glucose, thyroid function test, iron studies, ANAs, viral studies, BNP and NT-proBNP test are asked for. Then we go ahead with the chest X-ray. Next, please. Then we go ahead with the chest X-rays, and echocardiography is very important. As we know, the ejection fraction is the single most important measurement in heart failure. It helps define etiology and type of heart failure. There is no correlation between symptoms and the ejection fraction. Then we ask for cardiac MRI, coronary angiography, endomyocardial biopsies can also be done. Next, please. Now, treatment objectives for chronic heart failure. In the treatment objectives, we look at the prognosis, morbidity and prevention. In the prognosis, we try to reduce the mortality. For morbidity, we try to relieve the symptoms and signs, improve quality of life of the patient, eliminate edema and fluid retention, increase exercise capacity, reduce fatigue and breathlessness, reduce the need for hospitalization, and provide end-of-life care. For prevention, we try to prevent the occurrence of the myocardial damage. The progression of the myocardial damage is also taken, looked after. Then remodeling of the myocardium is tried. And reoccurrence of the symptoms and fluid accumulation and hospitalization, we try to prevent. Next, please. Now, treatment option for chronic heart failure, according to AESC guidelines, that is chronic symptomatic systolic heart failures, we use the diuretics to relieve symptoms and signs of the condition. ACE inhibitors or ARBs, if not tolerated, are used. We add a beta blocker, still NYHA class 2 to 4. Then we add a mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist. Next, please. If it is still class 2 to 4, if yes, then left ventricular ejection fraction is seen, whether it is less than 25% or not. If it is yes, then we look for sinus rhythm and heart rate greater than 70 beats per minute. If it is so, then we add the ivabradine. If still NYHA class 2 to 4 and ejection fraction less than 35%, we try to add. Next, please. Digitalis in that patient. And different other modalities like ICDs and CRTs are added. Now, management of patient with heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. ACE1, ARNI, beta blockers, mineralocorticoid antagonist, dapagliflozin, empagliflozin, loop diuretics for fluid retention. These are all class one drugs. then if the left ventricular ejection fraction is less than 35% and QRS timing is less than 130 millisecond and where appropriate, we put a implantable cardiac devices. If it is greater than 35% or device therapy not appropriate or inappropriate and symptom persists, then we look for other class 2 drugs. This class 2 is, we move on to class 2. For sinus rhythm and left ventricular ejection fraction less than 35% and QRS greater than 135 millisecond, we go ahead with the CRT. Next, please. Different comorbidities in heart failures, they impact the prognosis of the patient with heart failure, like COPD, hypertension, angina, renal dysfunction, diabetes mellitus, anemia, cachexia, obesity, depression, sleep disturbances, cancer, gout, hyperlipidemia, iron deficiency, anemia. This comorbidity may affect the treatment and worsen heart failure. Next, please. Now, lifestyle changes and dietary diet modification. Adopt a low sodium diet, less than 2 gram per day, 1 teaspoon of salt, which is equivalent to 2 gram of sodium, no extra salt in cooking. Avoid salty food like copper pickles. Avoid canned or boxed food. Check salt and fat content in the food levels. Restrict fluid restriction up to 1.5 to 2 liters per day. Reduce fat and cholesterol in diet. Monitor daily weight. Weight gain of 1.4 or over 2 days or 2.3 kg gain over a week, we need to see a heart specialist. Stop smoking. Eliminate alcohol consumption. Increase activity and exercise. The recommendations are 30 to 60 minutes of moderate to moderate exercise. Exercise aerobic activities for 5 to 7 days per week, supplemented by an increase in daily activities, which includes brisk walking, biking, and running. Next, please. Now, the imbalance, as has been told at the three key neurohumoral symptoms. There are the drugs which acts are beta blocker acts at the sympathetic nervous system, and the RAS inhibitors, where the ACE inhibitors or ARBs or MRA acts. Next, please. Diuretics. Loop diuretics are very commonly used, like furosemide and torsemide, for fluid control and to relieve help to relieve symptoms. No mortality benefit is from diuretics. Dry weight, minimal edema. The dose that we give for Lasix is 40 to 200 milligram per day. For torsemide, it is 40, maximum dose is 40 milligram per day. The adverse effect, common adverse effect that we see with diuretics are worsening of renal failure, electrolyte disturbances, hypokalemia, skin rash, phototoxicity, and neutropenia. Next, please. Now, the aldosterone antagonist, which includes the spironolactone or eprilinin, which has the mortality benefit, use cautiously in patient with creatinine above 1.5 or potassium above 5. Avoid potassium and salt substitute. Monitor sodium and creatinine levels. This drugs can cause a number of side effects, which includes gynecomastia. Next, please. Now, the ACE inhibitors. They improve survival in patients with all severities of heart failure, assess volume status, serum electrolytes, and serum function before initiation of therapy. Begin therapy low and titrate up every 2 to 4 weeks. Repeat serum electrolyte and serum status in 1 to 2 weeks after initiation or with dose changes. Contraindicated in pregnancy, advanced renal failure. If there is intolerable cough is there or side effect to ACE inhibitors are there, then we shift to ARBs. Next, please. The various other ACE inhibitors are that is captopril, enalapril, lisinopril, ramipril, quinapril, isinopril, and trandopril are used. The dose range have been given the chart, which we use as the target dose, like 50 BID for captopril, then 10 BID for enalapril, or 20 for QID for lisinopril, and so on. Next, please. Now, the beta blocker therapy, which improves mortality, starts in euvolemic state. Begin therapy low, start low and go slow, and titrate up every 2 weeks. Watch for worsening of heart failure. It is contraindicated with heart failure less than 60 beats per minute, symptomatic bradycardia, signs of peripheral hypoperfusion, COPD, and asthma. PR interval greater than 0.4 seconds for second or third degree block. Next, please. Other beta blockers that are used are carvedilol, misoprolol, metoprolol. Next, please. Digoxin given to patients with heart failure to control symptoms such as fatigue, dyspnea, exercise intolerance, shown to significantly reduce hospitalization for heart failure, but no benefit in terms of overall mortality seen. The dose recommended dose are from 0.125 to 0.25 milligram per day. Next, please. For the adverse effect due to digitalis, they have very narrow safety margins. That is why we can see they themselves cause arrhythmia, various types of arrhythmias. In GITs, they cause anorexia, nausea, vomiting, and abdominal discomfort or pain and diarrhea. They also cause headache, malaise, fatigue, drowsiness, confusion, delirium, hallucination, or rarely confusion. In the vision, we have seen there is blurred vision, chromatopsia, mostly due to yellow and green vision, and transient amblyopia or diplopia can happen. Next, please. They cause various arrhythmias like bradycardia, heart block, ventricular extrasystole, or ventricular fibrillation can also be seen. Next, please. Now, hydralazine plus nitrates. If intolerable to ACE inhibitors or ARBs, we add hydralazine isosorbide dinitrate, which is said as HISDN treatment, and which decreases the mortality, lower rates of hospitalization, and improvement in quality of life has been seen. That. Next, please. Now, medicines to avoid in heart failure, definitely NSAIDs are to be avoided. Thiazolidine, dions, metformin, and calcium channel blockers, except amlodipine, has to be avoided. Next, please. Now, ACE and AHA guidelines recommend incremental addition of treatment in HF progressors. Now, in the stage A, as we see, the goal therapy is to treat hypertension, encourage smoking cessation, treat lipid disorders, encourage regular exercises, discourage alcohol intake, illicit drug use, and control metabolic syndromes. The drugs that is mostly used are ACE inhibitors or ARBs in appropriate patients for vascular diseases or diabetes. Now, in stage two, goal therapies, all measures under stage A has to be used. Drug that is ACE inhibitors, ARBs in appropriate patients, beta blockers in appropriate patients, devices in selected patient, implantable defibrillator can be used. Goal therapies in stage C is all measurable measures under stages A and B, dietary salt restrictions, drugs for routine use like that is diuretics for fluid retention, ACE inhibitors, beta blockers. Drugs for selected patient like aldosterone antagonist, ARBs, digitalis, and hydralazine or nitrates can be used. Devices used in stage 3 includes biventricular pacing or implantable cardiac defibrillator. In stage D, all the appropriate measures of the stage A, B, C are used, but we need to appropriate the level of care in stage D. The options include compassionate end-of-life care or hospice care, extraordinary measures, heart transplant, chronic inotropes, permanent mechanical support, or experimental surgery or drugs can be used in this stage. Next, please. Now, prognostication. Prognostication in NYHA class 1, 1 year mortality is 5 to 10%, 2 to 3 it is 15 to 30%, in 4 it is 40 to 50%. Median survival is 16 months from first hospitalization. Median survival in all patients is not more than 2 years. But now with newer drugs, it may extend up to 5 years. Next, please. Now, PC palliative care needs in chronic heart failure at end of life, which has been clearly explained by WHO Atlas, that chronic cardiovascular disease have the most need, that is 38.47%, followed by cancer. Though we have palliative care more developed in cancer than in cardiovascular diseases. And next to follow is COPDs, HIVs, and diabetes mellitus or kidney diseases. Next, please. Now, specific needs of patient with heart failure. The most common symptom in large proportion of patient with advanced chronic heart failure include dyspnea, pain, cough, edema, and fatigue, as well as low exercise tolerance, anxiety, depression, sleeplessness, nausea, loss of appetite, loss weight, constipation, and other problems, often refractory to standard therapy. Patients with heart failures are also affected by frailty. Frailty is a biologic syndrome characterized by a decline in overall function and loss of resistance stressor. There are several pharmacologic and non-pharmacologic management strategies for common heart failure symptoms. Opioids are the first-line therapy for moderate to severe pain, unless the pain is caused by other condition. Non-pharmacological management includes massage, acupuncture, and heat therapy. Next, please. Dyspnea refractory to hemodynamic intervention, that is diuretic, after load reduction, inotropes can also be treated with low-dose opioids and benzodiazepine. Non-pharmacologic management includes using a fan to provide cool air to face, breathing training, and anxiety management. The first step is to identify depression and treat its cause, including pain and dyspnea. Selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor, that is SSRIs, are the most important used to as first-line pharmacologic therapy owing to their general effectiveness and limited side effects. Non-pharmacologic management includes exercise, psychotherapy, and cognitive behavior therapy. Next, please. Now, palliative cardiovascular care. Palliative cardiovascular care plays a central role in defining the scope and timing of medical therapies and in coordinating symptoms-targeted care in line with patient wishes, values, and preferences. Palliative care addresses advanced care planning, symptom relief, and caregiver/family support, and seeks to ameliorate all forms of suffering, including physical, psychological, and spiritual aspect. Please. Palliative care can along with ethics consultation, resolve conflicts centered on withholding and withdrawing or deactivating devices. In addition, palliative care specialists can provide expert treatment to end-of-life symptoms that arise in the setting of device deactivation and or facilitate referral to hospice and provide needed support to families and caregivers. Several factors concerning modern death with cardiovascular disease complicate end-of-life decision-making. There is a substantial variability in the timing of death following deactivation of many life-sustaining cardiac devices. Unless patients with ICDs are in refractory ventricular fibrillation or life-threatening ventricular tachycardia, timing of death can be highly variable. Next, please. Tottenberg demonstrated that large majority of patients undergoing left ventricular assisted device deactivation die within an hour. So decision about deactivation can be as complicated as deactivation itself. Kramer et al. Demonstrated that physicians are generally comfortable with withdrawal of life-sustaining interventions such as dialysis and ventilators, but are far less comfortable with deactivating ICDs and pacemakers. Older studies have demonstrated that a significant percentage of patients may consider deactivation to be akin to physician-assisted suicide or euthanasia, or the question of legality or deactivation. Next, please. Now, documents. Now, keys consideration in left ventricular assisted device deactivation. We need to document goals of care, DNR, DNI status, and decision to activate in medical records. Deactivate other life-prolonging intervention, example, ICDs, dialysis, medication, to fits, consider continuing mechanical ventilation, discontinue all non-symptoms directed monitoring, clearly communicate process and expect outcome of deactivation to family and patient, deactivated alarms before deactivating pump. Once deactivated, circulation of medications will be impaired. Bolus comforts, medication prior to deactivation should be given. Expect and treat rapid onset of symptoms. Next, please. Now, the various recommendations for integration of palliative care in chronic heart failures are from guidelines are provided, that is American Cardiac College or American Heart Association guidelines are there. Then it is from International Society for Heart and Lung Transplant, from European Society of Cardiology. Different guidelines are there, and levels of evidences are given, like ACC and AHA says it to be B-level evidences. Consider palliative care or hospice care throughout the hospital stay, before discharge, at the visit and after discharge, and during follow-up visit in selected patient. They also say palliative care and supportive care are effective for patient with symptomatic advanced failure, heart failure, to improve quality of life. Now, ISHLT says that palliative care consultation should be a component of the treatment of end-stage heart failure during the evaluation phase for mechanical circulatory support. In addition to symptoms management, goals and preference for end-of-life should be discussed with patient receiving mechanical circulatory support as destination therapy. Various ESC guidelines recommends it to be level A evidence. It recommends that patients with heart failures are enrolled in the multidisciplinary care management program to reduce the risk of hospital admission for heart failure. Likewise, the HFSA says it to be level C evidence. Next, please. Now, the NICE guideline, what it says about palliative heart care, it mentions that do not offer long-term home oxygen therapy for advanced heart failure. Be aware that long-term home oxygen therapy may be offered for comorbidities, such as for some people with chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. Do not use prognostic risk tool to determine whether to refer a person with heart failure to palliative care services. If the symptoms of a person with heart failure are worsening despite optimal specialist treatment, discuss their palliative care needs with the specialist heart failure multidisciplinary team and consider a need assessment for palliative care. People with heart failure and their families or carers should have access to professional with palliative care skills within the heart failure team. It is thought that a person may be entering the last 2 or 3 days of life. Follow the NICE guideline on the care of dying adults in the last days of life. Yes, please. Now, the result of a PAL-HF study by Rosa Joseph et al. Showed interdisciplinary palliative care intervention in advanced heart failure patients showed consistently greater benefit in the quality of life, anxiety, depression, and spiritual well-being compared with usual care, along measured using tools like Kansas CT cardiomyopathy questionnaire, KCCQ, functional assessment of chronic illness therapy, palliative care scale, that is FACIT-PAL or FACIT-SP, or HAT scales were used. Next, please. Now, when to initiate palliative care? Repeated episodes of heart failure over the last 6 months, despite optimal management, occurrence of malignant arrhythmias, frequent need for intravenous diuretics or their continuous administration, long-term poor quality of life, patients who have persistent MLHFQ scores more than 60 or Kansas score, Kansas City cardiomyopathy questionnaire scores less than 40. Or refractory NYHA 4-class symptoms and signs of cardiac ataxia are also seen. Initiate a palliative care. Next, please. Now, integration of palliative care in chronic heart failure. As we see, the time focus is to focusing on the relief of the sufferings, which may be relieved by taking good care of the symptoms, which includes dyspnea, fatigue, edema, and pain. Family assistance provided by the palliative care team, and the bereavement care after death care. That is psychological, and the psychological and spiritual supports are also provided with proper communication. Helping in decision making, that is shared decision making, helping progress of shared decision making, then preparedness, planning, and advanced care directives. It should be evidence based. Next, please. As we know, palliative care, the elements includes symptom relief, advanced care planning, spiritual and existential care, and also caregiver support or bereavement cares. Next, please. Now, it works as an interdisciplinary team-based palliative care, which includes, along with the cardiologist, the primary care, the palliative care physicians, the formal palliative care, then physiotherapist, occupational therapist, alternative therapist. People from communities are also included, like neighborhood, religious affiliations, or social services. But then social worker and psychologist are included in this team. Next, please. Now, as we see, since the heart failure has a very unknown trajectory of the disease, it is very difficult to estimate when the patient is going to die. So we see in the first red line that there is a decline in the quality of the life of the patient. This acute exacerbation is there, and then there is relief of symptoms. So we don't know when the patient is actually going to die. So we keep on, and most of the cardiologists, they keep on treating the patient, and thus the quality of life is hampered. But as we see in the next orange line, that is traditional care included disease modifying treatment used to continue. Along with it, what we used to do is we used to refer the patient late in the disease course. But as we see in the last, that is the purple line, palliative care should be included right from the time of the diagnosis of the heart failure. As we see, the graph improves, that is the quality of life and the intensity of care improves with the inclusion of the palliative care team. Next, please. Similarly, the slice says the same. That is the life prolonging disease trajectory. We see the all the disease modifying treatment used to undergo, and then hospice care or the palliative care were used to come into play. Now, with the in the cancer care, we have seen there is inclusion of the palliative care team right from the time of the diagnosis. At most of the places, they are early palliative care references have been made. So there is improvement in the disease means quality of life and the disease trajectory. As you see, there is more involvement of the palliative care team. But in cardiology, as we know, there should be involvement of the palliative care team right from the time of the diagnosis. But since the pathology of the heart failure the trajectory of disease is very uncertain, that is when we go ahead with the deactivation or stoppage of the treatment, we don't know. That is very difficult to predict. Next, please. Now, advanced care planning in cardiology, there is solicitation of patient values, goals, and preferences are taken care of. Then characterization of clinical status like functional ability, symptom burden, mental status, quality of life, and disease trajectory, perception from caregiver, estimation of prognosis, consider incorporating objective modeling data, orient to wide range of uncertainty, reviews of therapies like indicated heart failure therapies, treatment of comorbidities, appropriate prevention care, and advanced care planning and planning for future events are taken care of. Next, please. Now, as we know, there are two types of teams are there. Palliative care team, that is primary basic basic treatment, primary team which gives, and the specialist palliative care. Primary palliative care team and the specialist primary team provides the basic treatment, and the specialist provide the advanced treatment and complicated advanced care planning. Next, please. Now, education of the care team is very important, along with the education of the patient, families, and friends. Education of the healthcare policy makers are also very important, which includes prime notes are in that cardiovascular advanced care planning, decision making, withholding, withdrawing, and deactivation, device deactivation are very important for educating the care team. Now, for the patient and family, life limiting nature of the serious cardiovascular diseases, discuss patient values, appoint a surrogate decision maker, implication of device therapy, definition of palliative care, and the role of palliative care specialists are to be educated to them. Now, for the policy makers, we need to bring up with the policies like which are patient-centered nature of the palliative care and role of advanced care planning and goal of care discussion decision making. Next, please. Now, for any advanced care planning, we require proper communication. Effective communication between healthcare providers and patient is essential, especially in the chronic diseases such as heart failure. End-of-life discussions are often time-consuming and requires navigating the complex needs of patient and families. Most patient and families desire open and honest, accurate information on the disease involved. The first step to effective communication is to elicit the patient's belief, values, and goals. Next, please. Now, for the implanted cardioverter defibrillators, ICDs can prevent death from a lethal arrhythmias, but do not improve cardiac function unless cardiac resynchronization therapies with biventricular pacing is also indicated, and can add to burden, particularly if the ICD discharges inappropriately. So, proper communication regarding ICDs should be given to the patient, and a shared decision can be made. The 2013 ACC and AHA guidelines include a class 1 recommendation for implantation of ICDs for primary prevention of sudden cardiac death in selected patients with heart failure. Next, please. Left ventricular assisted device are increasingly implanted in carefully selected patients with advanced care failure who cannot undergo transplantation or for whom a suitable donor organ is not available. Deciding whether to proceed with LVAD implantation involves a complex assessment of the severity of the heart failure, comorbidities, frailty, caregiver burden, and lifestyle changes. The International Society of Heart and Lung Transplantation Guidelines for mechanical circulatory support include a class 2 recommendation to consult palliative care during left ventricular assisted device evaluation period. The society specifies that goals and preferences for end of life should be discussed as part of this consultations. Next, please. In 2013, the Joint Commission, a certifying body in the US, mandated that all accreditation for destination therapy LVAD program must have a palliative care specialist as part of the team. Patients with LVAD are at risk of strokes, bleeding, infection, and other complications that contribute to an average survival after implantation of less than 5 years. Next, please. Device deactivation. Decision around device around deactivation of these devices can be even more complex than the decision to implant them. Deactivating an ICD does not result in almost immediate death as it does with an left ventricular assisted device. Discussion around end of life and deactivation in people with left ventricular assisted device are especially complicated. With destination therapy left ventricular assisted device, death will occur with the LVAD in place. The opinion and comfort levels of the providers around LVAD deactivations are varied, with some providers viewing it as an act of euthanasia. Next, please. Now, shared decision making. Shared decision making puts patient-centered care into practice very important. It involves both patient and providers with ultimate goal of ensuring that a patient's values, goals, and preferences guide informed decisions are taken care of. This is particularly true in heart failure, where several medical decisions, such as whether to insert a left ventricular assisted device or ICDs, are preference sensitive owing to their high risk and high reward nature. Next, please. Now, there are various other aids which help the patient and palliative care team in decision making, and then the consulting team in decision making, which involves various forms of decision aids are available, and including pamphlets, videos, interactive web-based platforms, and books. There are also decision aids have been developed from some heart failure treatment, including ICDs, LVADs, which are available at the given this IP address has been given. However, decision aids are needed for other high-stakes decisions such as transplantation, home anatropic therapy, and hospice are still they must be taken care of and should come up. Next, please. Now, at last, what are the barriers to cardiac palliative care? We have seen, I've just mentioned a few of them. There are a number of barriers to cardiac palliative care, which includes uncertainty in the disease trajectory, failure to revive communication between healthcare providers and the patient. There is also siloed care, which we see very commonly, especially in India, it is very commonly seen. One department does not communicate properly with the next department due to lack of proper communication. The patient care have been compromised. There is lack of knowledge. An overlay of comorbidity and frailty has been the barrier. Life-saving devices with complex trade-offs are one of the important barriers. And of course, there is a very limited evidence base that is there in the cardiac palliative care. Thank you.
Kunal, excellent presentation. Arun, there are any questions?
Yeah, there is one question by Amit Jain. Question or comment? So I'll just read it up. Getting a palliative care referred early is very tough from cardiologist. anyone follows any criteria in your institute for such a reference? I think not only Kunal, but others can also comment on this. Cardiologist referral to palliative care.
Anyone wants to comment on this? Otherwise, I have an answer. So I think this is an important question which Arun has asked. Arun has asked this question. Arun, somebody has anyone? Amit has asked. This is an important question because you know palliative care is well accepted in oncology now, and with the perception that palliative care, only oncology patient needs palliative care, but making them understand that other diseases also needs and have a benefit. We all know that these people, now there are good evidence that all other chronic diseases like cardiac, especially cardiac neuro and pulmonary and other diseases, they also they greatly benefit by these palliative care. But you know, if cardiologist, nephrologist and pulmonologist, it will take time to make them understand that how you are going to be benefited. So this is very important that it is tough, but it is not impossible, because this is again with the experience, not with the evidence, that you have to go very slow. And you have to start introducing your subject in their continuum of care. And once they will realize the need and the benefit of the introducing the subject of palliative medicine in continuum of care of cardiac disease, I think they will start recognizing it. And you know, they will start believing that these people makes a huge difference in our patient's life. So it will take time. But somebody has to take lead from any whichever team which you are working to talk to these people and start introducing the subject. And you know, one more important thing works very well, that we should work with the symptom-based approach in these patients, not with the end-of-life care approach. Because you know, cardiologists, neurologists, they will never believe that their patient is going to die. So it is important that we should concentrate on the symptoms first. And symptoms as well as explanation of the disease. And this is absolutely true, that acceptance of the disease is much better when a palliative care physician is also integrating the care, continuity of care. So it is going to take time all over India. If we dream that everywhere in the all chronic disease integration of palliative care will happen, maybe if we will work very hard, those 68 people, those who have joined, if we will work very hard sincerely, then it may take 5 years. If we will not work hard and sincerely, it may take 20 years. So it is important that slowly we have to reach to these people that these therapies works. And we should not be discouraged that in India it is not happening. I have seen all other countries also. Everyone believes that heart transplant hoga, defibrillator work karega, devices lagayenge. So till the end, they ultimately die in ICU. So definitely it is a challenge, but it is not impossible, and slowly everything can happen. And start working on this, the leaders or the head of the departments or seniors, those who are listening this, I think wherever you are working, you have to start somewhere, and it will happen. Your consistent effort will make a huge difference, and people will start believing that integration of palliative care really makes a huge difference in day-to-day care of these patients. Dr. Preeti, you want to say something?
Good morning, madam. I agree with you. When now we have started rotation of our resident doctor to cardiac institute, and last year when they were at cardiac institute, every cardiologist were keen to know what palliative care people do, and thereafter they have started referring patients. So till that, we I think within 6 months we are getting more than 5 reference for only for pain management, but they want to know what they are doing, and they are repeatedly calling our resident. So I think now people are knowing what palliative care physician are doing. Same way in ITD, they are referring, I think every monthly one or two patients they are referring to palliative care department. So
this is my experience related to what other specialty people are. I want to say they're keen to know what is palliative care. Thank you. Thank you.
Yes, Dr. Stanley, you want to say something?
Yeah, no, just to thank you, Kunal, for a very exhaustive presentation. I think all of us, you know, have to develop this kind of relationship with our other specialists. And one thing that I feel we can all do is to start having combined clinics, you know, in nephrology, in cardiology, pulmonology, everywhere. Even if you like take 2 hours, you know, half a day, combined clinic, you can allot half an hour slots for everybody. And they can come and we can sit together and we see the patient together. And the patient also and family also feel comfortable that, you know, very nicely, you know, care has been handed over or together we are working together for that. So combined clinics is an answer for rapid development of this kind of integration, I feel. Thank you.
So absolutely right. I think once you will start integrating, they will be calling you that, please come and sit in my heart failure clinic.
Yeah.
Come and sit my end stage renal disease clinic. So this will happen, but again, it will take some time and it will also need patience and persistence. So Arun, are there any other question?
No further question. Amit Jain has shared that he's making a referral criteria based on PPS and effect on escape scoring, and he would like to share with you and get feedback. Thank you, Dr. Jain.
Okay, Amit, right now you want to share or you will send it?
I think he wants to send it. Not now, later.
Okay. So if there are no questions, we can end this lecture. Thank you very much, Kunal, for an exhaustive and very nice presentation. I think it is difficult for these boys to prepare these presentations when they are not actively started working in these areas, but still he has really worked hard that how palliative care can help and when to refer palliative care physician and when actively palliative care can get involved. I think this was a good presentation, Kunal. And thank you everyone for joining, because it makes a huge difference that how many people have joined in the morning, and this gives encouragement. So lecture 3 series will be getting almost over in next 3-4 lectures. And then we will have a break for 2 weeks, and then we will start very fantastic series of lecture, and just wait for the next series, because next series is going to be very, very interesting. And it is going to be absolutely interesting for all those who are doing basic care, those who are doing specialist care. So please wait for the next lecture series lecture series 4. And once we will finish these three, four lectures, we will announce that what exactly we are planning to do in the lecture series 4. So thank you very much, Kunal. Thank you, Nisha, Archana, Arun, and everyone for joining. Have a nice week.
Thank you so much, ma'am.